In this video, you'll be learning about this topic. Hey, so this kind of topic is interesting because when I hear complaints or you hear the FUD on Twitter, one of the things that comes up a lot of the times is this idea of hashing power being consolidated into a specific region. And the one that is most often brought up is China. And I think that what we were just talking about is this vote of a full node operator and the corporate governance, you know, is the terminology I'm using for that node operator having a vote. I think you get into a really interesting discussion when you combine that with this idea of concentrated hashing power. So I'm curious to hear some of your thoughts on that idea.
A lot of that hashing power is in China right now. And the reason is actually much more practical than you would think. Essentially, a lot of chip manufacturing is in that region. A lot of heat sinks and parts, transistors and all that stuff, it's all manufactured over there. So it's not a surprise that a lot of the people that can take advantage of that are Chinese. In addition, they also have a lot of really cheap electricity, in large part because the Chinese government has subsidized the construction of these like very large hydroelectric dams. And basically in the middle of nowhere, right? Like, because if you're building a dam, you don't want it near a population center, because if something happens to the dam, then the population center is screwed. So these are often in the middle of nowhere. And as a result of that, because of electricity transmission costs, what you end up having is these dams that can generate a lot of electricity, but it's not worth transmitting them to sort of the nearest city beyond a certain amount because it costs too much. So the uniqueness of Bitcoin mining is that the mining equipment can actually be moved. It's portable and you can put it wherever there is electricity. And a lot of these Chinese miners, they have access to the equipment and they were able to go to these hydroelectric dams during rainy season when electricity is especially cheap, and get a lot of that excess capacity and use it for mining and so on. After rainy season, they might go elsewhere and so on, but that's sort of been why mining has been concentrated in China. But the latest reports that I'm seeing is that less than 50% of all hashing power is now in China. There are countries that you wouldn't expect that have a significant amount of hashing power right now, including countries like Iran, which apparently currently has somewhere around 8% of all hashing power, which I think is more than Canada, which is kind of crazy. There are other places like Russia and Kazakhstan and Sweden and Iceland that have access to really cheap electricity that end up going towards those as well. Now, as far as sort of the decentralization aspect of this hashing power, if China went offline tomorrow, if the Chinese government said that it is illegal to mine in our country and just completely like raided all of these mining facilities and shut them down, what would happen? Well, you'd still have the other 50% of hashing power. And that means that blocks would be slower, fees would be higher, but the Bitcoin network would still chug on. And in fact, this was one of the arguments during SegWit 2x, was even if the miners held 80% of the hashing power, which we thought was on the high end of all the miners that would cooperate with SegWit 2x, Bitcoin would still have 20% of the hashing power. So, you know, you get 50 minute blocks, hour blocks, something like that. It would still keep chugging along. And because Bitcoin has difficulty adjustment every 2016 blocks, after 2016 blocks pass, then it goes back more or less towards 10 minutes anyway. Now, it's possible that the miners collude to try to attack the network, and there was a lot of discussions around that, but that ends up not being that much of a threat, just given what we've learned about different forks. For example, Bitcoin Cash right now has like 1.5% of the hashing rate of Bitcoin, and any large miner could easily attack Bitcoin Cash, but they don't, in part because, you know, they don't matter. In a sense, if you've already won, then you don't really care. And the thing is, like, the economic game theory is such that whatever has the more economic value, that's where miners will be incentivized to go. You'd be mining at a loss and have a tremendous opportunity cost if you mined on a worse chain. So even if, you know, Bitcoin at that point had 20% of the hashing rate, the other 80% would be mining at a loss. And you know, they would either go bankrupt or have to switch. So in a sense, the miners, this is one of the things that we recognize after game theorying out everything, is that the miners work for the network. It's not that the network works for the miners. And that was one of the big key things that we learned out of that whole year, was that wherever the miners are, economically, they are incentivized to go with the strongest network, the network that the users want. And that's why users are ultimately sovereign over the entire network.
Thanks for watching. Make sure to subscribe and hit that notification bell so you don't miss out on the next podcast episode and new investing resources.
What are your takeaways and thoughts on this discussion? Let us know in the comments section below.